So today we are going to discuss about how to conduct rescue operation and recovery work after a mine explosion with some case studies and with respect to regulations, mine rescue rules 1985. Okay, so mine explosions, we have discussed mine explosions are generally regarded as a very serious and constant hazard in mining sector. This is about how to rescue survivors and recover dead bodies from a mine in which a disaster has occurred. Rescuing survivors is the most rewarding part of your job as a mine rescue team. So we have discussed about the mine rescue team. Their job is to rescue the survivors. If anybody is trapped inside the mine because of the mine explosion, you have to rescue them. So that is the main job of the rescue team, to rescue the trapped miners inside the mine. So what is a rescue system? What is a rescue system? The rescue system is nothing but locating the survivors. So after the explosion, if some people are lost inside the mine, then you have to locate the survivors, opening refugee chambers and alternatives so that the survivors can be taken refugee in the underground chambers. And you have to find out the people who are injured survivors, and you have to give them first aid and bringing back survivors out of the mine. So this is called your rescue system. The rescue system is to locate the survivors after an explosion, opening refugee chambers and alternative places, and provide first aid to the injured survivors and bring them back from the mine to the fresh air base, and from the fresh air base, bring them back to the surface. This is the job of the rescue team, and this system is called your rescue system. Then what is recovery system? Recovery is rescue, and these are two parts. So recovery system means locating the dead area in a mine, condition of the bodies, the people who are dead lying inside the mine, what is their condition, what is the condition of their body, handling the dead body, how to take them out from the mine, and surviving families, how to deal with the people, their family members who have lost their earning member. So this is recovery system, rescue system and recovery system. So what is rescue, or what is locating the survivors? How to locate these survivors? Okay, the people after the explosion, the miners after the explosion who are trapped inside the mine, they are not dead. So they are called the survivors. So you have to locate the survivors and bring them back to the surface. So while entering into a mine for rescuing purpose, survivors may be found in open passageways, perhaps along the escape routes, injured and unable to walk out of the mine. So while entering into a mine for rescuing purpose, survivors may be found in open passageways, perhaps along the escape route. They are injured and they are not able to walk out of the mine. So that is why you need to help them, to bring them back to the surface. It is important to both look and listen for the clues while searching for the survivors inside the mine. Miners who barricade themselves into an area will usually try to leave indications of where they are barricaded to aid rescuers in finding. So in some instances, teams may find trace footprints indicating the direction of the survivors are taken. When listening for clues, one should be on the alert for any noise such as voices or pounding on rails or pipes. So these are the clues you have to locate these survivors. When the survivors are located, after locating the survivor, their location, their identities, and their condition should be reported immediately to the command center. The command center is situated at the surface. You have to report them after locating the survivors. The command center can then send in a backup team with any equipment that may be needed, such as stretchers or breathing apparatus. So after locating the survivors, if they are not able to walk, then you have to bring them by the help of a stretcher. Or if they are not able to breathe, so you have to provide them breathing apparatus. So this is the rescue operation, rescue team they have to carry out to locate the survivors. So this is a refugee chamber where the miners can take shelter in case of an accident. This is called a refugee chamber. So opening the refugee chambers, refugee alternatives or barricades. So this refugee chamber, after the explosion has taken this, the survivors might have entered to this refugee chamber and they must have locked from the inside to protect their life. So how to open the refugee chamber or the refugee alternative or the barricades? If a refugee alternative, refugee chamber or barricade is located, then you have to try to determine as quickly as possible whether the miners inside are still alive and conscious. Verbal communication or noises should be created so that those inside can respond. If there is no response, do not assume the miners are dead. They could be unconscious. If there is a response, try to find out how many miners are inside, and then you will have a better idea of what medical supplies you may need when you reach them. Ask if they have used their self-rescuers and how long they have been inside. So this is very, very important to locate the survivors inside the refugee chamber. So this is an airlock refugee chamber. The safest procedure for getting survivors out is usually to advance fresh air to the barricade by the quickest means possible. So this refugee chamber should be taken to the fresh air base. Once the fresh air is advanced, the barricade can be opened. Then after that, you can open the barricade. Sometimes, however, it may be necessary to rescue the survivors before fresh air can be advanced to them. For instance, fresh air cannot be advanced to the survivors if a fire is spreading and moving in their direction. In these cases, an airlock should be established outside the refugee chamber or barricade before it is opened. Okay. So some miners might have got some injuries and they are injured inside the mine because of the accident. Injured survivors, because of the explosion, because of the inundation, or because of the fire, some miners might have been injured and they are surviving. They are called the injured survivors. So after survivors have been found in the mine, the next step is to get them to safety and fresh air as quickly as possible. In some cases, survivors may need emergency first aid treatment if they can be transported. It is of two types. The first type is called triage system. Second is psychological factor. So what is a triage system? When several survivors suffering from physical or psychological trauma have been located, the accurate sorting of priority victims may mean the difference between life and death. This sorting of victims is commonly referred to as a triage system. The survivors can be categorized into three priority groups according to their condition or injury. One thing to remember when dealing with any injury is to stay as calm as possible. Sometimes, when faced with a gruesome or unnerving sight, the best thing to do is to take a deep breath and continue to breathe fully and deeply until the job is finished. It helps also to try to concentrate on the fact that what you are doing is a job, and that job is helping someone else to continue living. So this is the way you can deal with. So the triage system, this system is called your triage system. First priority, what you have to do in the triage system: airway or breathing problems. The survivors may be having severe bleeding, might be taking place because of the injury, deep shock, they might be very much shocked, they must be unconsciousness, second degree burns covering more than 30% of the body because of the fire, third degree burns covering more than 10% of the body involving hands, feet, or face, inhalation of poisonous gases, dismemberment, and chest injury, severe head injury. This is the first priority. These people in the triage system, this is the first priority, second priority, third priority. This is called the triage system. So in the first priority, these are the people who are having much more problem. So those people are to be attended first. Airway or breathing problems, severe bleeding, deep shock, unconsciousness, second degree burns covering more than 30% of the body, third degree burns covering more than 10% of the body or involving hands, feet, or face, inhalation of poisonous gases, dismemberment, chest injuries, severe head injuries. Then second priority is multiple lacerations, multiple fractures, second degree burns involving 15 to 30% of the body, third degree burns covering less than 10% of the body, not including hands, feet, or face, moderate shock, moderate heat exhaustion, back injuries with or without spinal injury. This is the second priority. Then third priority is minor bleeding is from the injured minors. Then first degree bonds and 15% of third degree bonds involving less than 2% of the body, fractured arm and or foot, mild heat exhaustion, obviously dead. So this is called a triage system. What is triage system? Priority wise, they are categorized into three categories. First priority, second priority, third priority. The people who are much more dangerous, much more injured, you have to give priority to them. And less injury, second priority. Further less injury, third priority. So this is called your triage system. Then what is a psychological factor? Psychological factors. Psychologically, some survivors, when survivors are found, their behavior may range from apprehension to uncontrollable hysteria. The best way to relieve psychological stress in survivors is to try to communicate with them as soon as possible. Most importantly, the communication must be continued. Whether survivors are showing signs of hysteria or not, they should never be left alone. You should make every effort to assure them that they will be helped. Survivors should never be allowed to walk out on their own. Even if they appear to be in good shape, they will need your assistance and support in leaving the mine. You may even need to restrain a person to prevent them from bolting into fresh air as it is near. So this is the psychological factor of the survivors. Then bringing the survivors out of the mine. If somebody is injured and unconscious, so you have to bring them back to the surface and treat them, bringing survivors out of the mine. If survivors are found in contaminated or questionable air, they will need to be given breathing protection if they are to be transported to the fresh air base. If a survivor is able to walk, he or she should be positioned between two rescue team members and guided out to fresh air base. If the person is unable to walk, a stretcher will have to be used to bring that person out of the danger area. Then what is recovery? We have seen that rescue and recovery, there are two parts are there. One part is rescuing the survivors, and second part is recovery. In the recovery stage, you may find some dead bodies, locating the dead body area, locating the dead body area. When a team locates a body, the usual procedure is to report the location to the command center. You should also mark the body's location and position on the mind map and on the route for rape goes to the body. It is suggested that a team member outline the body with chalk or paint on the floor, or at least mark where the head and feet are. When a body is first located, every effort should be made not to disturb any possible evidence in the evidence. Will be important later. In user, that is not the team that actually does the body recovery work. The recovery of recovering dead bodies than others. Rescue workers, especially those recovering bodies for the first time, may very well begin to feel sick or apprehensive. The best advice for them is to try to work with a busy, business-like and professional attitude. Most of your reactions to the situation will be from your senses of sight and smell. Then handling the dead body. If some people are dead inside the mind, then how to handle their dead bodies? Normally, when dead bodies are brought out of a mine, they are placed in rubber body bags, rubber, and brought out on stretchers. If body bags are not available, the bodies can be wrapped in British cloth or canvas. When dealing with dead bodies that have been underground a while, you should be sure to wear rubber gloves. Also, the bodies should be sprayed well with a disinfectant before you touch or handle them. Then, this is all about the rescue and recovery. Then, there are some case studies carried out in some mines where the incident has taken place. One case study is Monongah mine explosion in West Virginia. The accident took place on Friday, December 6, 1907 at 10:28 a.m. An explosion occurred that killed most of the men inside the mine instantly and has been described as the worst mining disaster in American history. The first volunteer rescuers entered the two mines 25 minutes after the initial explosion. The biggest threats to rescuers are the various fumes, particularly black damp, a mix of carbon dioxide and nitrogen that contains no oxygen, and white damp, which is carbon monoxide. The lack of breathing apparatus at the time made venturing into these areas impossible. Rescuers could only stay in the mine for 15 minutes at a time, not more than that. In a vain effort to protect themselves, some of the miners tried to cover their faces with jackets or other pieces of cloth. While this made filter out particulate matter, it would not protect the miners in an oxygen-free environment. The toxic fume problems were compounded by the infrastructural damage caused by the initial exposure. Mines require large ventilation fans to prevent toxic gas buildup, and the explosion at Monunga had destroyed all of the ventilation equipment. The inability to clear the mine of gases transformed the rescue effort into a recovery effort. One Polish miner was rescued, and four Italian miners were also escaped. The official death toll stood at 362. 362 people are found dead inside the mine at Monunga mine explosion, West Virginia. Then another mine explosion took place in Sago mine, West Virginia, United States. The explosion occurred at approximately 6:30 a.m. in the morning at the beginning of the first shift after the mine reopened after the New Year's holiday weekend. 5 4-man teams tried to make their way through the entry, and they had reached 10,200 feet into the mine. It was believed that the trapped miners were somewhere between 11,000 to 13,000 feet from the entrance. Two 6.25-inch holes were drilled from the surface into an area where the mine for 10-minute period did not find any signs of life. Air quality tests performed through the first hole indicated that carbon monoxide levels in that part of the mine were at 1,300 parts per million ppm. Officials call this very discouraging. Then a third hole encountered groundwater and could not be drilled all the way down. Then experts expected that a third hole, if successful, could expand the opening and provide a better way of rescuing the miners than proceeding into the mine. The first hint of the miners' status came around 5 p.m. on January 3rd, when it was reported that a body had been found. In the early morning of January 4th, 41 hours after the incident began, 12 of the miners were found dead. The remaining miners were found at the working face of the second left portion of the mine, some 2.5 miles from the mine entrance, behind a rock barricade structure. So, this is the two case studies carried out to know the condition of the dead body after the explosion has taken. Mine Rescue Rules 1985. Mine Rescue Rules 1985. Mine Rescue Rules have been framed under the Mines Act. Okay, so the second part is now we are going to discuss about the mine rescue rules 1985. So mine rescue rules have been framed under the Mines Act 1952, keeping in mind the occurrence of emergencies in mines, particularly in below ground mines due to explosion, fire and inundation. Mine rescue rules framed under the Mines Act 1952 provide for setting up rescue stations, rescue rooms, appointment of superintendent, instructors, rescue personnel, rescue room in charge, etc. Specifies the duties and responsibilities of these persons, organization and conditions, provisions on maintenance of equipment in mines, conduct of rescue work, etc. So, relevant provisions of the mines rule, relevant provisions of the mine rescue rule 1985 is 1.1 with the application, section 1, rules apply to below ground mines. 1.2 is definition, section 2. Below ground mine means any excavation which extends below superjacent ground. Chief inspector means the chief inspector of mines appointed under section 5 of the act. Principal official means the senior most mine official in mining discipline on duty in the mine. Rescue room means a rescue room as established and maintained. Rescue trained person means a person certified by the superintendent to be rescue trained person. Then establishment and location of rescue station, section 3. Chief inspector may permit the owner of a below ground mine or a group of below ground mines to establish and maintain rescue stations. At every rescue station, there shall be appointed one superintendent and at least two instructors. There shall be maintained a rescue brigade of not less than 18 rescue trained persons. Function of rescue station, section 4. Functions of rescue station shall include imparting initial training in rescue and recovery work, imparting refresher training to the rescue trained persons, providing support by its own rescue teams and equipment in case of major accidents or long-lasting rescue and recovery operations. Carrying out the functions of rescue room in respect of these below ground mines where there is no rescue room. Then establishment, 1.5, establishment and location of rescue room, section 5. At every below ground mine where more than 100 persons are ordinarily employed below ground and there is no rescue station within its radius of 35 kilometers, the owner shall establish and maintain on surface close to mine entrance a rescue room. It may be sufficient to provide one rescue room for a number of mines belonging to the same owner where the total number of persons ordinarily employed in below ground workings of all such mines does not exceed 5,000 and the mines are situated at a radius of 35 kilometers. What is the function of a rescue room? A rescue room shall provide facilities for the storage, assembly, testing, and adjustment of breathing apparatus and other rescue equipment and apparatus and for their speedy transport to the mines. Then what is the duty and responsibility? What are the duties and responsibilities of the superintendent, rescue station superintendent? The rescue station superintendent shall be in overall control of the rescue station and the rescue rooms served by such rescue station. The rescue superintendent shall ensure that all the rescue equipment and apparatus are kept at the rescue station, rescue rooms, and at the entrance of the below ground mines under his control are maintained in perfect working condition. Inspected by instructors at specified intervals, and tests are conducted and adjustments are made. The rescue superintendent shall ensure that adequate stock of spare parts and supplies are kept for maintaining rescue equipment and apparatus in perfect working order. The superintendent, rescue station superintendent, shall submit to the chief inspector and to the regional inspector detailed report on the functioning of the rescue station and rescue rooms under his control in the preceding year on or before the 20th day of February of the succeeding year. Okay. Here, duties of the instructors: impart course of instructions and practices to persons selected for training in rescue and recovery work, as well as to rescue trained persons and maintain a record thereof. Make inspection, test and adjustment of rescue equipment and apparatus and maintain a record thereof. Instructors shall not leave the rescue station without prior permission of the superintendent. In the absence of the superintendent, the instructor shall be in charge of the rescue station. Duties and responsibilities of the rescue room in charge. He will display prominently a list of mines served by this rescue room, maintain the equipment and apparatus kept at the rescue room in perfect order, not allow any unauthorized person to enter into the rescue station or rescue room, or permit any unauthorized person to take out any apparatus or equipment from the rescue room. The duties of rescue trained persons posted at the rescue stations are defined here. They should obey order of the superintendent and instructor and assist them in discharging their functions. Attend to messages, telephone calls, and wireless and maintain record thereof. Maintain the equipment and apparatus kept at the rescue station in perfect order. Not leave rescue station without obtaining prior permission from the superintendent. Then what are the duties of rescue room attendant? Not to leave the rescue room until relieved by a substitute. Not allow any unauthorized person to enter into or take out any apparatus or equipment from the rescue room. To telephone calls and maintain a record of that. He has to obey orders of the rescue room in charge and assist him in discharge of his duties. Okay. Then appointment of rescue trained persons in the mines, their disposition and accommodation. The manager shall ensure that at least 5 rescue trained persons are readily available at the surface. It shall be the responsibility of the mine owner to provide suitable accommodation to them, close to the rescue station, to the superintendent, to the instructors, to the members of the rescue brigade, close to rescue room, to rescue room in charge, rescue trained person, and attendants attached to it. Duties of manager in emergency. Inform the owner of the mine, agent or manager of nearby mines to make available these services of rescue trained persons employed therein, if so required. Inform the rescue station about the nature of the occurrence, stating whether assistance would be needed from the rescue station or not. Summon medical assistance and send information of the occurrence to the regional inspector of the mines. Then entry into below ground mines for rescue or recovery work. No person shall be allowed to enter a below ground mine or part thereof which is unsafe for the purpose of engaging in rescue or recovery work unless authorized by the manager or in his absence by the principal official of the mine present at the surface. Only rescue trained persons shall be permitted to enter the mine for the purpose of using self-contained breathing apparatus. Then rescue team members and their duties. The number of persons in any rescue team using breathing apparatus in a mine shall not be less than 5, not more than 6, including the leader or captain. Members of rescue team shall, in general, use the signals for communicating to one another in traveling with rescue apparatus on. Every member of the team shall keep the pace given to him when numbering up. If the pace is too quick or if distress is felt, the member shall at once call attention to the fact. Then lastly, obligation of the mine owner, agent, and manager in certain situations. Whenever emergency arises at a below ground mine, whether served by a rescue room or rescue station or not, the owner, agent, or manager may seek assistance or additional assistance, as the case may be, from the nearest rescue room or rescue station. And in such an event, all possible assistance shall be promptly rendered by the rescue room or rescue station. And the owner of the mine shall pay to the owner of the rescue station or rescue room rendering such assistance. So this is, today we have discussed about rescue and recovery work in the mine. Rescue and recovery work in the mines. So what is rescue and what is recovery? Rescue means you have to locate the survivors. So after the explosion has occurred, who are the people who are trapped inside the mine? You have to locate them. The rescue station members, rescue team members, they have to go to the mine, locate the people who are trapped inside the mine, and they are called the survivors. And these survivors are to be taken to the surface by the rescue team members. So that is called your rescue operation. Second is recovery. So in the mines, after an explosion, some area may be called a dead area, means where all the people are died. Nobody is surviving. So the job of the rescue team members to locate the dead bodies, and those dead bodies are to be taken to the surface with the specified rules and regulations. So that is called your rescue and recovery work in the mines after an explosion. And we have also discussed today two explosions which took place in two mines in United States of America, Virginia State. And the number of people died and the work carried out to locate the survivors, we have discussed. And at the end, we have discussed about the mines rescue rule 1985. So as per the mine rescue rule, you have to maintain a rescue room, and the rescue station would be headed by a rescue superintendent. There shall be some instructors, rescue trained persons, who will carry out the rescue operation in case of an emergency. Okay, so minimum six people, minimum five people, six people should be there in a rescue team, which we have already discussed in the previous classes also. The captain, the vice captain, the fresh air base officer. So minimum six team members are needed to carry out the rescue operation. So the captain will be on the front, behind him the map man, the stretcher man, and the tail man. All the five people will be there in a team to carry out their job in case of an emergency situation in the mines. Their job is to rescue the survivors if some people are injured and they are found trapped inside the mine. So you have to take them out from the mine. So that is the rescue. And if some people are dead, then the recovery work is to be carried out. Bodies are to be taken to the surface. So this is the work we have done today. Today I have explained all these things, rescue and recovery work in the mines. So hope you must have understood what is a rescue and what is recovery. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
तो नैतिक रूप से लगता है.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.